Okay.
Do you want me to start it? Are you introducing
it? Yeah, it's already started.
It already has.
Good morning. Welcome to the Roy Branson Legacy Sabbath School. And this is the second in our series on Adventism Behind the Iron Curtain. The last time we looked at Romania, and we will continue that with Peter talking to us about that more later on in the spring. This morning we get to hear from Ted Levterov. Ted is the director of the LNG White State branch here. And also he's a historian in the School of Religion. For this one, I'm trying to get to the camera. And he's a wonderful friend and scholar. So very joyful, very buoyant. And you play much soccer.
Oh, yes. It's part of my religion.
Right. When you looked at football originally here in the United States, you were disappointed?
Before I came here, I decided to do a search, a little bit about the culture. You know, it's always good to put yourself into the context. And I was so excited because I saw that you guys have the football league. And I went to my dad and I said, man, I'm going to feel at home in the United States because they have this football league. And when I came, of course, it was in another. You guys don't play football. You don't use your foot and you don't play with the ball. You play with an egg, so.
Okay, thank you. Now, there looks like something good to eat, but we'll hear about later. Let's begin with prayer. Dear God, thank you for the Levterovs, thank you that they've come so far to be with us and serve us. And thank you for the beautiful nation of Bulgaria. Help us to learn more about that today. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, David, for the invitation to talk a little bit about Bulgaria. We have a great tradition back home, okay? Usually, you don't invite guests. The guests invite themselves, okay? So you don't have to call, right? So we have to learn that here, right? But whenever you have a guest, it's in our culture to serve, you know, something to eat. Even if you're not hungry, you have to eat. And so we have a little, we call it pita, so you have to stay until the end. And you have pita with some Bulgarian special, It's not a salt, but it's herbs and salt a little bit. So usually we call it čubrica, okay? Čubrica, it's a healthy thing. It's usually, we do this when you have guests or at weddings, and it means that we wish you well, you know, that you will be fed all the time and so forth. So it's a little custom, but let's do it at the end, okay? Don't rush here now. It is enough for everyone. Okay. Adventism behind the Iron Curtain. Now, I'm getting old, okay, but I lived my first 21 years under communism. So I know a little bit about what it's like. Not as much as my parents, like the previous generation, not as much as Peter, but I experienced some things. And so today I want to share with you what it meant to be an Adventist in that context. I'm guessing that throughout the lectures, listening about Romania and next week about, you know, Yugoslavia or Croatia, Serbia, whatever, you will see that there's a lot of similarities, okay? But that's how life is. But each of us, I hope, will give our own perspective, and you will not only learn intellectually things, but you will get inspired of how God works through different means and in different situations. And I hope that you will see that. So what I'll do, I will just tell you very briefly. I mean, when I started doing the PowerPoint, I don't know when I can finish, but I would like to leave some time for questions at the end, okay? There are so many things that I wanted to cover, so I had to cut a lot of things. But I want to give you a little overview of how Christianity came to Bulgaria, okay, just 1-2 minutes. And then how Adventism came into that little part of the world, and actually came from Romania, so I'm glad that I speak after Peter. And then I will let you know how Adventism survived during communism and what happened afterwards, and finish with a couple of personal experiences. Good? All right, let's go for it. By the way, two things before I begin. Really, if you search, even if you Google history of Adventism in Bulgaria, you will not find much, because we really don't have a written history of Adventism. We have one which was written in 1938 by Alfred Thomas. He was a worker, but it's an old history. And I have begun to write the history, but David knows, we have so many projects, okay? And so hopefully I will finish the project, but I have begun to gather materials from the General Conference archives and other resources and archives, something about our history, and you will see even in my presentation that some of the dates, okay, if I'm mistaken, please excuse me, but I have found some discrepancies, and I'm trying to figure those things out, and it takes time, but I'm trying to write a short history of how Adventism is. So this is a work in progress, okay? But at least it will give you the overview. And the second thing, now you will notice that I will not have too many pictures, okay? Because it was a luxury to have a camera during that time. We couldn't afford to have a camera. I mean, today we have the iPhone and everybody is now, you know. Yesterday we had a meeting, and Zdravko Plantak, my colleague, I mean, he is huge on Facebook. He just took a couple of pictures, and in 15 minutes we were on Facebook. You know, but that was a luxury. During that time we couldn't. I wish we could. I have also begun, I have a couple of friends, including my father, to gather pictures so we can also, you know, visualize and see some of the stories. But I have few, but not many, okay? Okay, let's begin. Bulgaria, for those of you, you know, who think that Bulgaria is in Africa, no, it's in Eastern Europe. I'm saying that because once I was asked that. But it's in Eastern Europe. It's just on the very east side. And you see here, we are bordering with Turkey. So the major way from Western Europe to the Middle East comes right here through Bulgaria. Now, that's why we have been involved in every war. All right, and we always got on the wrong side, but that's another discussion. So we are bordering here with Greece, Turkey, and above us in Romania, this is the border, the Dunay River, and as you see, we have a Black Sea, and so forth. A beautiful, small, beautiful country of about 8 million people, a little bit less, but about 8 million people. This is the flag of Bulgaria. It has changed through the history. It symbolizes freedom, the greenery, because we have a lot of nature. I'll show you some pictures, and of course, the blood that was shared for the freedom that we have. This is the seal. It also went through, our first seal was a tail from a horse, because the old Bulgarians, they were, you know, horsemen. But the seal, if you notice, the hands are together, I'm sorry you don't see the whole thing, but it says that the unity makes you stronger. Okay, that's the kind of the motto. The unity makes you strong, and that's why you have the hands. And Bulgaria was, why unity? Because it basically was created by three tribes. The Slavic tribes, the Thracians, and the Bulgars. Okay, So they mixed together, and that's how they had a kind of a, we call it a Khan, you know, the Khan. And he kind of united those tribes, and Bulgaria was established quite early, actually, in 681, officially. They started gathering together in the beginning of the 5th, 6th century, but by 1681 is the time when officially the Bulgarian, you know, old kingdom was established, and we were initially a pagan nation. A lot of gods and, you know, pagan rituals and so forth that have been discovered. So that's how the nation began. Very soon, however, we accepted the Christianity, you know, the Christian tradition. That's happened in the 9th century. And it is very interesting that it was related to the creation of the Slavic alphabet. Okay? So with the creation of the Slavic alphabet, that's how Christianity came. And you have the two brothers, Cyril and Methodius. I don't know why, you know, it's every written Methodius. It's really Methodi. So it's Cyril and Methodi. But the Cyril and Methodius, the two brothers, now there's a huge discussion what kind of, you know, now we claim that they're Bulgarians because their mom was Bulgarian, okay? So we claim that, but the Greeks, they claim and so forth. Then there's a huge discussion, so we'll not go to that. But they created the Cyrillic alphabet in the 9th century and from the Greeks. So let me show you here. We have a lot of, you know, monuments celebrating. Even the 24th of May, it's a national holiday in my country, celebrating the creation of the alphabet and knowledge. It's a day of celebration, the human knowledge. But that's kind of the initial alphabet. If you see, there's a lot of similarity with the Greek alphabet, because they were born in Thessalonica, which is about 2 hours from the border of Bulgaria, but they were born there, and that they created the alphabet there. When the Moravian king, Rostislav, and I'm talking, you know, that time, just to give you the background, learned that, you know, that these two brothers created a new alphabet, which is a Slavic alphabet. And the Moravians also, I mean, they had Slavic roots and so forth. They invited the two brothers to go, and because they translated the Bible, they invited the two brothers to go to Moravia, so they crossed to the Bulgarian, you know, part, and went to Moravia to evangelize people, to preach in the Slavic language to people. And as they were doing that, they had a great success, because people now were not listening only to the Latin version of Christianity, okay? They were listening to Christianity in their own language, so they had a great success. And they got so famous, the two brothers, that they were invited by the Pope. Pope Nicholas I invited them in Rome. And in fact, they have always been considered as a saints in the Roman Catholic tradition, but Pope John Paul II canonized them, you know, as really being a saint and so forth. So they invited them to Rome, and this is a slide of how the alphabet has, by the way, evolved, okay? Today, this is the alphabet that we have, about 30 letters. So from 46 went to 32, and now to 30. It was revised lastly in 1948. And if you see, it's kind of different. I was really confused when I started studying English. Because you see that? Which letter is that? H. Well, it's M. Right? Which letter is this one? B. No, it's R. Okay? So you can get easily confused, but anyway, that's the alphabet. So, when Cyril and Methodius were preaching there, they had great success, but guess who got really upset? The bishops! Okay? The leaders of the church, they got really upset, so they kicked them out. And so that's how they went back towards Greece, and they ended up in Bulgaria. And there was a tsar at that time called Boris I. And this ruler accepted Christianity, and he ordered Cyril and Methodius to evangelize in the Cyrillic language. No Latin, nothing else. No Greek, I mean, just the new language. And that's how Christianity, I mean, he got baptized, and we have a kind of a little photo from that time, not a photo, but just a drawing from that time, how Boris first got baptized, and he made officially Bulgaria a Christian nation. Okay, so that's the story, really, the short story. By the way, at that time, Bulgaria was a very influential country, because if you notice, today Bulgaria is like right here. Okay, that's Bulgaria. Look, during that time, in the 9th century, the 10th century, we were down here up to Athens, and you don't see it, but and we kind of grew up to Moravia here, and even to near to Constantinople. By the 12th century, the Bulgarian kingdom, which is the second kingdom, as the historians call it, became even larger. You see where Constantinople is. So we almost, you know, here at that time. Look where Athens is, and we're almost next to Athens. So during the Boris first, and then Tsar Sen and so forth, Bulgaria really grew and was a powerful kingdom. And of course, Christianity was part of that.
Were you part of the Eastern Empire or the Western Empire?
Of the Eastern Empire. So, but you see, we were at one time bordering with seas, you know, a lot of the, so that started to shrink when, oh, this is another picture again to see. We went almost to Finland up there, see? So a lot of growth on that. But in the 14th century, we were conquered by the Ottoman Empire. And the story is long, but Bulgaria basically divided, and that's why you have, you know, unity makes you strong. They divided into four parts. They were conquered by the Ottoman Empire. But what kept Bulgarians, really, the Bulgarian spirit alive, was that faith. And so we were under the Turkish yoke for about 500 years. And how did Christianity survive? You have heard that in Eastern Europe we have a lot of monasteries. Okay? Up in the mountains, that's how Christianity survived. I'm going to show you one of the, I think it's the biggest on the Balkans, on that area, the biggest monastery. It's a tourist attraction. It's called the Rila Monastery, where it was kind of the, during these 500 years, this was the flame where Christianity kept on, you know, burning during that time. This is some pictures of the Rila Monastery, a lot of, you know, art. If you know anything about Orthodox Christianity, we have a lot of art. Some more pictures. It's up in the mountains. So we have a lot of, if you see here, I put it, but you see all these signs? These are all monasteries in the around Bulgaria that kept Christianity alive during these 500 years. All right. So how did Adventism begin? Now, we got freed by the Russians in 1878. And since then, we have had, you know, kind of warm relationship with Russia because of that, a lot of monuments and so forth. But it is shortly after that Adventism, okay, came into the small nation. By that time, we lost a lot of land and so forth. And really, it came through Romania, through Russian immigrants from Crimea. You know the place, you know, they're still fighting about it, you know, the Russians and the Ukrainians. But people from Crimea, they came through Romania, they spent some time there evangelizing, being missionaries, basically. And then they crossed the river, the Dunaj River, and they came to Bulgaria. Then people in Germany heard about this. So this happened in the 1891, if I'm correct, okay? That's why I didn't put a date, but I think that they came in 1891. In 1892, there was a German, and I cannot find his first name yet, but Brother Wagner was sent from Germany to help with you know, being a missionary, teaching people about Adventism and so forth. And a few years later, we have the first baptism in 1896. This is either 1896 or 1898. In the little history book that I have, it's 1896, but I went to the Facebook of Early Adventists. You know that they had a Facebook? You know that? It's called Review and Herald. So I went to Review and Herald, and you know, you can find a lot of gossip there. I mean, they have everything, you know, pictures, songs. It's like a Facebook, but 19th century Facebook. So I found that that Conrad makes he writes a letter, and it says that it's 1898. It's written in 1898. So, but around that time we have the first baptism of Jacob Grimberg. He is a Bulgarian Jew. He is the first baptized Adventist in the, you know, what is known as Bulgaria, in the city of Rusia. And I'll show you the map so you can kind of see where that is. And you have the first group of Seventh-day Adventists established in Rusia. Now, I'm just making a pause here. This has nothing to do with Bulgaria. But we just discovered a book and an image of Michael Chekhovsky. Now, we usually, when we talk about Adventist history, we say that our first official missionary is... Come on, you know. Jane Andrews. But we don't give really credit to this gentleman, because Michael Chekhovsky was the first unofficial missionary. And he established more than 200 churches, including near Romania and Russia and so forth. And it's because of him, as far as I have been able to detect, because of him that we have these people going back to Bulgaria. So we're kind of related to Michael Chekhovsky. And the story is really interesting, because he became a Seventh-day Adventist from the Catholic tradition. And after 8 months, he went to the brethren at the General Conference and said, "Could you please send me as a missionary?" He was Polish by birth. "Could you send me to Europe? I want to evangelize." And they talk about this about 1 week, 2 weeks, and they said, "Well, probably he was coming from the Catholics, you know, so it's, you're still not versed very well in Adventism." So they declined his request. But the guy was he had some Bulgarian, you know, mentality, because he went to the Advent Christian Church, okay? Do you know the Heims group, the Miller group? And he asked them, and they sent him, they sponsored him. But when he went to Europe, I told you he was Bulgarian, he was preaching the Seventh-day Adventist message and distributing, you know, Review and Herald and all this, you know, Facebook. So he was a tricky guy. But he's the one that really helped with Adventism in the eastern part of Europe. By 1911, Bulgaria became a mission field. And we have the first leader from Germany. So we have most of the leaders initially came from Germany, as it was, you know, the strongest Adventist field there. K. Motzer was basically established as the first president of the mission field of Bulgaria. At that time, we had two workers and about 25 members. In fact, until 1920s, Adventism didn't grow very well, because Orthodox tradition in Bulgaria was and still is very strong. And I'll show you how that happened. So it was a difficult period. We had only about 3 churches and about 85 members by the 1920s. So you see, there is some growth, but not tremendous, from 25 to 85. Let me show you that. So Adventism came really here in Rusia. You see where Romania is? So they came from Crimea through Romania, spent some time in Romania, came to Rusia. So you have the first church, the first baptism right here. So the 3 churches are here, and then in Gabrovo, and then in Sofia. Okay, so by 1920s, that's what happened. Not tremendous growth. Now, everything began to change towards mid-1920s. And look how it really, why Adventism began to grow. There are some lessons that we can learn even in contemporary Adventism, 21st century. In 1926, because Adventists were afraid to establish really churches, okay, or to establish officially the denomination, they created the so-called Christian Adventist Society with a primary purpose not to evangelize, but look what to do. To do moral education and health living, particularly for the youth. You see what they're doing? Adventism began to grow because Adventists very cleverly started to be involved in the society. I mean, behind it, their mind was the mission, right? To grow Adventism, but they began to be involved and they created this Christian Adventist society with the purpose to educate the young people, you know, to live moral lives, to live healthy lives, temperance and so forth. And that's even the first part of the early literature that they created. Under this society, they began to publish. Okay, so you have the first publishing house, the New Life, established, and the first church building. But they didn't call it church. I mean, it was a building for this society was created. And you have the beginning of the colporteur ministry. Now, today, colporteuring, it's, you know, it's kind of a done deal. I mean, it's gone. But that was huge. It was a web page. Okay? It's like today you're creating a web page and you promote your things or your mission. That was what happened. Now, this is the building. You see there, this little house. Adventists bought this little house and they built the first church in Sofia. Well, it was not a church officially, but for that society. And it still stays there. I mean, if you go today, it's a little bit remodeled, but the church outside looks exactly the same. So they use the auditorium for lectures on health and, of course, religion. And they use part of the second and third floor for other educational purposes, including printing of books. So that's how they began to promote Adventism, basically being involved in the society. Here is the, what do you call it, like the bylaws of the society. Okay, and I just give you a little snippet of that. The purpose of this society is to help the moral and cultural development of people, particularly the youth. And I'm translating here. The Christian Adventist Society will achieve its goals by printing and distribution of Christian and health literature and through public lectures. You see what they're doing? Bulgarians are clever, you know, they try to maneuver and so forth. What is interesting that the king, at that time Bulgaria, it's a kingdom. We were a kingdom by 1944. The king actually approved. Okay, so we have in our archives, we have the, this is a note from the king. I mean, he responded, right? By a telegram to and said, congratulations on your new society, you're doing good and so forth. So the king kind of approved that, and they began to print literature, which had a lot to do with doctrines and health. So that's how Adventism began to grow. A little story. Before even we had a publishing house, one of the first religious books published by a Protestant denomination was the book Steps to Christ. It was published not by an Adventist in 1899. And I have a copy, we have the original, I didn't take it because it's very fragile. But that's a copy of the book Steps to Christ that was published as early as 1899 in Rusev, you know, in the upper part. So that's how Adventism began to grow. This gentleman here, let me see his name, Nature Nachev. He was the leader of the corporate ministry of, you know, distributing and so forth. And those are some of the people how they basically began to spread the gospel and some other pictures. Okay, so that's how Adventism began to grow in the 1920s. Up to that time, very little growth. They continued with the same approach. Look what they did. In 1936, they opened a children camp for orphanages, for orphans and also kids that poor and so forth. It was a free camp, and they took them every summer, and they educated them in different crafts and agriculture and so forth. So again, you see, they bought a place, but they didn't create a church. They created a, you know, something that they could help people. And so Adventism, that's what's really valuable about our Christian faith. It's not only theory. I mean, we're theologians. We like to argue things, and you know, it's in our Adventist blood. But Adventism is much more than that. It's what Jesus did. You know, so that's how at least the Bulgarian Adventists did it in those early years. So it was for orphans, for socially disadvantaged kids. And at that place in Svoge, so it's somewhere in the middle of Bulgaria, they also established the first school and the seminary, which existed only for about 6-7 years. And it was closed when communism came. Okay. But look at the growth. Look, because Adventists began to be involved, what happened? 1,344 members, at least 10 churches, and in 48 we created the union. Officially now, Bulgaria was officially recognized. You have the Union of Bulgarian Churches in two conferences, North and South. So that's the early stages of Adventism. Everything changed in a few years. So for 20 years there was, you know, good time and so forth. When communism came in 1944, after the, with the Second World War, everything changed, because suddenly you have Adventism kind of going behind the Iron Curtain. So I like the title, right? But that's how this happened. In the 40s, so I'll give you a very brief overview, because I see that my time is really running. 1940s and 1950s, you have the beginning. Immediately after, you have the communist government, which started to promote atheism and Darwinism and all these, you know, things. Immediately after that, a repression began. And look what they did. You remember how Adventism spread? Facebook, you know, publishing books and distributing and so forth. I mean, the communists are clever people. Look what they did, the first thing that they did. They closed the web page. No web page. So you have the closing of the printing house, they closed the school. So you have very few people that attended the school in Bulgaria. Things began to really become worse towards 1970s. They dismantled the two conferences. They stopped the constituency meetings. Now, I grew up with that. We had a legal constituency meeting for the union, the Bulgarian Union of Churches, in 1990. After the fall of communism. So for about, 30 years, we did not have constituency meetings. And you'll say, well, how was the church led? Well, the leaders of the church were given to us by the government. Okay? So you did not have a choice. They were given to us by the government. And of course, you have the infiltration of the government within the church community. So you couldn't know and you couldn't trust even your brother. You see what I did? So sometimes I joke with Dave and, you know, my colleagues, because I said, you know, when I came to this country, one of the first things that shocked me a lot was that people trust you. You tell them something, they trust you. Not in my mind. You tell me something, the first thing that I have is like, oh, come on, give me a break. Okay, but that's just how I grew up. You don't trust people and you don't talk, because you may disappear. Okay? Like my dad disappeared once. My mom didn't know where he was for 2 days. Okay? So So you have the leadership of the church enforced by the government, but look, it becomes really worse. And I call this the time of survival. We just try to survive, to stay alive. And honestly, at that time, we were so out, I mean, we were cut out of the of Adventism. So much so that after the fall of communism, I was told that there is Andrews University and Loma Linda University and these are Seventh-day Adventist institutions, and I was shocked. I didn't believe it. I said, are you saying that this belonged to the church? Well, yeah. I was like, no, it cannot be. Mm-hmm. We didn't know, you see, disinformation. So you have becoming really worse because they began to close churches. I asked my dad, and at one point, we had for about 60 churches, they became 15. They closed churches, but you will see how we survived. Because immediately we started to having home churches. Gradual firing of pastors. So if you were caught to give Bible studies, you could have your church as a pastor, but you could not give Bible studies. Okay? If you are caught, you could be put to prison or fired. My pastor, where I studied, was fired because you know he was giving Bible studies. There were few instances where, not too many, but at least 5-6 pastors were put to prison or they were confined to a small village. If you have your church, I mean, so the punishment was, okay, you can go to this small village and you cannot leave it. You live there. It's like a prison, but you are, you know, free in that little space. New pastors were approved only by the government, but they had to give a special loyalty report. So you had to go to the government and sign a loyalty report that you will go and say what, you know, what is going on in the church and this and that. Not that, you know, but the government wanted to know. Okay, so that's how pastors were at that time. Very few new pastors. And this is very interesting. You see that? Every pastor had to sign a local registry. In other words, if I'm a pastor at Loma Linda, I cannot go and give a Bible study in Redlands or go and do any work in Redlands. I'm at Loma Linda, and if I am caught beyond the borders of Loma Linda, I'm in trouble. That's how my father disappeared, you know, because he went to the nearby district and so forth. So, but you see, it's becoming worse and worse and worse. And another thing, it was not only with pastors, also with young people. In Bulgaria, you had to go to do a 2 years military service. And I guess it was probably the same in Romania. And if you did not, you know, some people decided to keep the Sabbath. They were put in prison, and there's so many stories. Young students were expelled from school. Now, I kind of underlined that because this is my first story. So let me tell you really quickly. I told you, it's so many. But this is my story. I was studying in a music school. In my previous life, you know, I was a musician. And I was pretty good, probably, because they sent me to different competitions. And during communism, if you win competitions, the government give money to the school. So I was pretty good. You walk around the town, and you see a poster with me and my piano, you know, so I felt really proud. And I didn't go to school on Saturday, on Sabbath. You had to go to school 6 days. It's not like here. But I got free Sabbath from the very beginning, and I was a good student. I had all A's, but they changed the principal. And I'm giving you the shorter version. This lady, she was the wife of the mayor. So she called me into her office. It was February. It was Tuesday. I don't remember the exact date, but it was February, Tuesday. She called me and said, Ted, next Sabbath, I want you to come to school. And I said, but yeah, but I don't. And she said, if you don't come, I'm going to expel you. And she let me go. And I was thinking to my mind, you will not expel me. you need me. I win competitions, you know, and this and that. I mean, I went to, and you could hear, you know, they played on the radio, local radio station. I said, you need me? So, and I prayed. But by the way, that was my conversion experience. That's when I really began to think about faith in God, because I went back home and I told the story to my dad. And usually you expect your dad, who is a pastor, to tell you, well, you don't go. And my dad said, listen, you're 15, you have to decide for yourself. Man, I'm telling you, I didn't sleep that night. I didn't. Because I was deciding, I mean, I'm famous, come on, God. And I was sure that God would do a miracle. I was 100% sure, like Paul. So Sabbath, I decided not to go. My parents were happy, you know, because of my decision. And I went Monday, sure that, hey, it's a miracle. She called me to my office and said, pick up your books and go home. You expect. That walk to my house was probably the hardest in my Christian life. Because I was arguing with God like Job. You're trying to be faithful to God and look what happens to you. And I argued with God, and that's the only time I said, God, I don't love you. That's not how you treat, you know, people. See? Anyway, it's a long story. Sometimes, David, you can invite me. I can tell you the whole story. But it really became worse because her husband sent letters to every school in the area, let's say, you know, the Riverside, you know, district, and we went from school to school to school to school, about 20 schools, and no school wanted to accept me because they had my name. And one of the principals told my dad, he showed the letter. You see? And so I had to go to another place and so forth. But you have these kind of stories, you know, time to survive. I have been stopped going to church, stopped by my teacher not to enter the building. Because it's not for young people, I mean, who believes in God and so forth. So you have government agents who are sent to churches. I have experienced that several times. They just come in, they don't say a word. They just come in, pick up your Bible, your songbook, and whatever literature we have, they put it in a big plastic bag and they left without saying a word during the meeting. So you have that. Bible was forbidden and so forth. And as I told you, the church was close to outside Adventism. How did the church survive? Well, they closed the churches, but we began to get together in house churches. So, the role of the community. We had a very nice lecture this past Tuesday by my colleague Dr. Rice, and he talked about that. I was reminded, Dr. Rice, during your presentation about that. The role of the community. Church was not only on Sabbath. Okay? Church was every day for us. And we got together and we encouraged each other and so forth. So these house churches, sorry, I'm rushing a little bit. Every member was a minister. Pastors couldn't do it? Well, the church was involved. So in fact, it was a terrible time, but in fact, my best memories about Adventism are from that time. You know, sometimes we have it so easy. You have unwavering pastors, really strong pastors who decided that they are not signing anything and they were ready to die for their faith. And we had an alternative leadership of the church. So we have the official union, you know, leaders, but they were connected with the government, and we had an alternative leadership that met secretly several times in my own home. And we began also to print literature, because it was forbidden, underground. Now, I know there are a lot of ethicists here. We can talk about the ethical implications, but we just did it against the law of the government. I was involved with that as well. It's another story. But we were five people. Even until today, we have not revealed ourselves. But we started printing because what happened in the 1980s, the government gave one Sabbath school lesson per church. That was what you were allowed. And the practice was after the second service, you know, after the sermon, we stayed and the elder or whatever, the deacon will dictate the title for next week, you know, the Holy Spirit, you know, the memory verse, and you write. Well, but in the church you have about 40 old ladies. They cannot write so quickly. What do you do? So we had to spend the whole afternoon writing for them, you know. So we got fed up and we smuggled the old German machine, printing machine. So I have a book here that is from that machine. It's the Advent Home, okay? So you can see what the book is like. We smuggled the machine. And I was a student at that time, so you see why I was kicked there? I went to another city and there we were five people, started beginning to print that. To cover it, because it was very noisy, to cover it, we played, at that time were famous, the AC/DC, you know, Rainbow. You remember these guys? We bought all the cassettes, there was a cassette at that time, and all of our neighbors thought that we are, you know, young people crazy about hard rock music. We hated it, but you know, we just and we covered the noise because it was very noisy. So you see some of the pages, you know, you had to push it through it by hands. But that was a good time for us. And by the way, a lot of pastors also typed books. Okay, so this is Selected Messages, Volume 1. This is how my father typed that book. But just for you to see, so a lot of ways to survive. Okay. Printing literature, and on Sabbath we would deliver. I mean, we had a special code. You know, how many tomatoes you want, you know, and this and that of flowers, and how many boxes. So we distributed throughout all Bulgaria the Sabbath school lessons, and we began printing Ellen White books, and some other books as well. But that was a time that kind of united us, and there's some incredible, miraculous. What I think stories, because one Sabbath morning I was just taking a shower, so I was with you know, ready to get into the shower. There was a knock on the door, and two policemen came. Now we had a place where we kind of, you know, put the machine, the printing machine. It was a small German machine. But what do we do with all the paper that we had? We had a room full of paper. So they just came in, you don't talk to them, they don't talk to you. They just came in and started going from room to room. And they entered the room with all the papers. Now, I was sure that we were going to the police station and jail. Because you have a room full of papers. We bribed a gypsy guy, he gave it. So, two things. Either an angel of God came and closed his eyes. Their eyes, there were two. Or either they didn't want to jail us. Okay? Those are the two possibilities. Okay? It's impossible not to see it. So either one of those two options. Anyway, that's I wanted to give you some time. And that's why I say by faith alone. You know, sometimes you have to believe. I know we're theologians. I know that, you know, we're in a place where we use science and so forth. And it's great. But there are times in life when you have to only believe. You know why? Because we know our story. But we forget that above our story there is a grand story. And that's why I like Adventism. And that's called the Great Controversy. And sometimes we try, especially as theologians, and I'm guilty of that, we try, I mean, I'm Greek-minded, okay? They have to be explained. But sometimes in life there are things that you just have to shut up and say that you don't know. And that's where faith comes, okay? Seventh-day Adventism after that, it was a religious awakening, so I'll make another lecture about that. But basically the church tripled after the fall of communism in 1989. This is another story how we did the first evangelism. I got famous again. I mean, I was on the TV and every radio station, national radio station, because we decided to do evangelism like in the West. And we thought that it will not happen. I mean, we had not a clue what we're doing. But we organized evangelism in our church, which sits about 300 people. We put extra chairs. There were about 700 people fighting. I'm telling you, fighting, fisting, you know, about who can enter the church. We couldn't hold it. And that's how we got, you've heard the story, you know, we got the biggest hall, the communist hall in my city. But that's another story. I'll tell you the story another time. And we got all the television, radio stations, so forth. But there was like an explosion, which new churches, we built about 80 to 90 new churches. And we began to educate pastors. We opened a school. And I'm sorry I had really to rush that, but I'll tell you this story some other time. Today, after the 2000, so that was for about 10 years, you have kind of a diminished interest in religion. And for the first time, unfortunately, last year, we had a minus growth. It's a very little, but for the first time, it's a minus growth. Now, it's not only because we don't baptize people, but a lot of people also went, you know, after we became part of the European Union, they went around and so forth. Like, they had a huge growth in Spain because of Romanians, you know that? I mean, Spain hasn't grown, you know, for years, and now suddenly they have a huge jump in membership and so forth. But it's a complicated issue. But, you know, that interest that was in the 1990s is basically diminishing, and we're becoming much more a secular society. So let me finish. Today we have about 116 churches, approximately 100 little groups. So that's how we are trying now to grow Adventism, through little groups, about 70 pastors, 68 membership. There's a little drop. We were about 8,500, but there's a little drop there. Attendance, a lot of people that attend. And this is significant. The Bulgarian church, it's a young church. The mid age is 35 to 45. You know why? My father's generation grew up under communism, and they are not interested in faith. It is their children that are joining the church. It's a very interesting phenomenon, but that's a lot of psychological studies need to be done. Sociological studies. But the church is really, really young. If you go to Bulgaria, you will notice that it's a young church, and so forth. Okay, this is a few pictures, and then I'll. From Bulgaria, I can play you a video, but we don't have time for that, so next time. But Bulgaria, as I told you, have a lot of mountains on the west side. A lot of mountains with some natural lakes. This is the Seven Lakes phenomenon in Rila. That's the mountain. This is the... We also get snow, okay? So if you like skiing, you have some beautiful resorts. We also have the Black Sea on the east side. So if you're like me and you don't like snow, you've lived in Michigan for 9 years, that's the place to go. A lot of, old castles and stuff like that. Some of the beaches that we have. In every city you also have what we call the old town. Okay? From the 19th century, that's how the houses look like. In my own city where I grew up in Plovdiv, that's part of this. Beautiful, old houses, a lot of art and architecture and so forth. This is part of, this is our, the parliament. This is the presidency here. Church, that's the most famous church in the middle of Sofia. It's just in the middle. And that's how they built Sofia around that church, the Orthodox Church. As I told you, they don't have they have no benches in the Orthodox churches. Okay, people stand up and so forth. So that's how you listen. You see people are standing around. This is the National Library. And of course you see this. This is Cyril and Methodius. This is the History Museum. The art and this is a place where you have the biggest kind of auditoriums in Bulgaria. So we do evangelism here as well. It's a cultural center, the theater, some of Sofia, and so forth. Okay, but we started having malls. So I said I have to put this one so you can see that we also have it. But it's a recent phenomenon, 2-3 years ago. And we also have time from Romans. You know, we have the amphitheaters. Concerts are happening here, and of course we are known for music, not Bulgarian music and so forth. Okay, any questions? I'm sorry. Yes?
Were Adventists treated differently than other Christian groups or Islamic groups? I'm not thinking of Orthodox, but, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses, Baptists.
Yeah, all the Protestant, all the non-Orthodox groups were treated differently by the Bulgarian government, and even the government interfered in the religious liberty of the Orthodox Church, because they were also set, their leaders were set by the government. They were the KGB, you know, people, the leaders of the Orthodox Church. You could not even go to an Orthodox Church if you were a teacher, for example. If you taught in a university, you couldn't go to an Orthodox meeting. So, but officially, there was religious freedom and the churches were open, the Orthodox churches. But all other denominations were treated the same, so it's not only Orthodox. Yes?
How does the church support, when you're really in this depressed state, how does the church financially support or emotionally support the people in Bulgaria?
By
is there underground methods or
it's not politically correct, but yeah, by using tithe and you know, just not supporting the union in an official way. So underground, yes.
And because of modesty, you didn't mention in the history of Bulgaria, the moment of their apogee when they are attacking Constantinople.
Yes.
Certainly in the capital of the Byzantine Empire. And they were very, it was very difficult to push them back. Also, because of that, we have that moment with Bulgaroton, the Byzantine Emperor that caused the eyes of 14,000 Bulgarians and after they defeated. But also I want quickly to mention that you were mentioning the two people, Cyril and Methodius, that were Christianizing the Bulgars and the Slavs in this area. And the bishops, the opposition of the bishops. We didn't have time, but the opposition was not because they were preaching the gospel, Christian gospel, but because it was a problem of language. They didn't want the Pope, of course, he was with the Latin language, the Patriarch in Constantinople was with the Greek language, and these were the two official languages that they were accepting. And Cyril and Methodius want to spread the gospel, the Christian gospel, in the Slavic language.
Yes. Yeah, I thank you. I did not make that very clear, but yes, that was the main reason. You do worship in Latin, you don't.
Okay, let's thank Ted for being here. Next week we begin this series, 6 weeks, called American Awakenings, and we'll have historians here talking about early Adventism, so you want to be there. Ted, do you want to say something about this, or Mrs. Levterov?
Yes, please come. As you leave and take a piece, it's a Bulgarian pita, it's very traditional, and there's a little salt, so help yourself. So we have napkins and I think enough for everyone to have a good bite. Okay?
Thank you so
it's not only see, but also taste. Okay. That's what Adventism is all about.
let's have the benediction. Here we go. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
This is where the food is.
Okay, please come. Don't be shy. Okay, that's for you.
So we're going to have another one on Romania. We have to get you going. Yeah. It's interesting to hear about Adventism.
Yeah.
Oh, it's there. I go through the books. Oh, shit. Well, that's good to see.
Okay.
welcome. It is called Gaida.
And is it a wedding history? Or is it
It's like, you know, the Scottish how they have the Bible. But it's a similar to the Scottish one, but a little bit different, but the same. Huh? What do you mean? Yes.
You need anything else, David?
Yeah,
I'm going to take off.
The
cemeteries
where they found the pyramids. Yes. I have been there. Yes. It's amazing. But you can see it. It's they discovered so many things. The city that was born, where you have a rich home, they discovered the starting point, which is going to be enlarged and more structures. So it is a great thing.
So if you go to
do that, it's amazing. So now we have, you know,
as a baby,
there's a lot of there's a lot of stories.
It's really good. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
And I told you, well, thank you.
Oh, welcome,
really
welcome.
Good.
Flopping, you know what flopping is?
Okay, I will call you sometimes.
Hey, I'll tell you what, you know, Bud, if you met Bud, you had to sit back. His son-in-law was home in Chester. A big Man U fan. But really, the best game.
Oh, yeah, I know that from you. I mean, I have learned that lesson.
It's the hand. That's the evolution.
Which is your hand?
But I'm going to say it's a hand. Development of hands. That's what makes a human being different from the animal. Anyway, thank you very much.
Oh, well,
but you should have told me. You should have told me. You should have said, that would be
more
my time.
No, I mean, I didn't want to go on with that.
Hey,
you can
have
that.
Because I'm not
a little bit too long.
I don't know, just try. based cell. Can my in the smaller village, you go in the supermarket and they sell can make bread. It's a long one, it's swollen.
Yeah,
it's very delicious. Yeah. Industrial bread.